remember the day.
Yes,
I gave my heart to you, Lord. You told me if I
trust you,
you would never
leave me.
Good evening, friends. This is Brother Julius one more time on the Just Word Show. We are so excited to be here. We're always glad to be here to share from the Word of God. If we believe that's one of the things that God wants us to do at this point in our lives, we always like to encourage folks to read the Word for yourselves and get to know your Lord and your God through the Word, which is always safe. To get to know the Word. And that's why we call it the Just Word Show. Mm-hmm. We appreciate the fact that folks have opinions. We appreciate the fact that everybody's entitled to an opinion. But when it comes to the kingdom of God, your opinion is just your opinion, plain and simple. It's just your opinion.
Yes.
The thing that means the most and that carries the most weight is always going to be the Word of God, and it always should be the Word of God. It is the Word of God that brings life. It is the Word of God that sets free.
Yes.
It is the Word of God that washes. In the book of Titus, chapter the regeneration, it washes, it regenerates, it cleans, it so it's the Word of God. It's the final authority. I always encourage folks to memorize portions of it. I always encourage folks to read it all the way through, mm-hmm. at least once. I'm to a point in my life where I'm even trying to encourage folks to read it all the way through every year. I understand people's lives. They can't, you know, you work or whatever, but you have to take in a portion of the Word of God on a regular basis.
Yes.
It is the thing, that will cleanse your ways. It will clean your ways. It'll wash your soul. It'll help you to renew your mind. It'll help you know what causes you to know what God says on any topic that He addresses. And once God speaks on a topic, His word alone is the final authority. Did you have anything to add?
No, I was well, not anything in depth, but I just wanted to say I know some people are getting very excited. Today has been a beautiful day in terms of temperature-wise, and so we are on the precipice of the change of season, so in about 6 days, it's going to be the first day of spring, and so I know folks are excited to kind of peel back the layers and... it seems like it's been an extremely long winter, I know, but it really hasn't. I've heard people say, you know, the weather is schizophrenic, is spring still coming, you know, but the truth is, you know, God even controls the seasons.
Yes.
Even back in the book of Genesis, where He said, let there be lights in the firmament of the heavens. that divide the day and the night, and let there be signs for the seasons and for the days and for the years. So the Lord is still on the throne. He's still supreme. He's still God. And so we just want to wish you a happy spring.
So where we are, we're on the East Coast.
Yes.
The Mid-Atlantic region.
Traditionally four seasons.
Right. So it's four seasons here where we are.
Yes.
And this is March the 14th. Yes, the 14th.
Yes.
So since it's March the 14th, it is really, really good to see a 60-degree day after having come through the winter that we came through. So once again, we're thankful. We're glad that you gave us this opportunity to share on your cell phones or on your computer screens and your automobiles and your living rooms, however it is that you're listening here to the Just Word Show. So look, we're getting ready to get into the Word because we are Word people. And we always encourage you folks out there in Radio Land to be Word people. Watch this, friends. As I was getting ready for the show, I had some images to come into my mind. I'm going to try to put these images in your mind. The power of God to renew, regenerate, and rehab. Listen, three R's. Okay. Renew, regenerate, and rehab. Or you can switch the order. It doesn't matter. The power of God to rehab, renew, and regenerate. And as I was preparing for the show, I thought about some illustrations because I had pictures in my mind of this concept. The power of God to regenerate, to renew, and to rehab. Can you imagine, friends, let's say an investor, and it is his job. He just wants to invest in something. Mm-hmm. And let's say he just wants to buy a house because he wants to invest in real estate. Mm-hmm. Just use that as an example. And he walks into a house. The house is tattered. It's old. It's worn. Let's say it's 60, 70, 80, 100 years old. And not much maintenance had been done on it. The furnace is worn out. And the floors are leaning. And the roof is leaking. And there's plumbing problems. And the grass is overgrown. And it's just all kinds of issues with the house. The reason why the investor is an investor and other folks are not is because, number one, the investor walks into a tattered situation and he sees something that the regular person does not see. Mm-hmm. He sees potential of what this tattered situation could be. Mm-hmm. If I put my resources into it. Mm. Second reason, the investor has resources to put into it. Mm-hmm. Well, I got resources. Mm-hmm. I'm just looking for something with potential. Mm. Listen, the power of God to rehab, to renew, and to regenerate. Mm-hmm. God is in the business of walking into the house of your life. It's leaning. Mm. The floors are creaking. The colors are faded off of the wall. The plaster's falling off of the wall. Mm. The plumbing is leaking. And there's all the grass is overgrown, busted windows. But the investor walks in and says, "Ah, I see something here. Find out who the owner is and let's make him an offer." Mm. Because there's something that I can make here.
Yes.
And it's beautiful. Mm-hmm. And the thing about it is his friends may look and say, "Well, what in the world are you going to buy that old Caddyshack for?"
Right. They don't see the vision.
Because you don't see the vision I see. Because I'm going to buy it. Because I know that I can make something beautiful out of this situation. I can rehab it, I can regenerate it, and I can renew it. Oh, there's another R word.
Mm-hmm.
Restore.
That's good.
And this is the business that God is in. God is in the business of renew. Now look, you might be jacked up, you might be broke up, you might be busted, tore up from the floor up, you might be disgusted. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. I don't care what you're into that you're trying to get out of. I don't care what you're addicted to. I don't care how many times you've been arrested. I don't care how I just don't care what your record is. I don't care how jacked up your credit is. I don't care how bad relationships you've been in. God is in the business of renewing, rehabbing, regenerating, and restoring.
Yes.
And that's good news.
It's great news.
I thought about another example. Could you imagine a person? And some of you may know folks that do this. They're just going around purchasing automobiles. And the whole purpose for purchasing the automobile is because they want, this is the one I've been looking for. It's a 19 whatever. And it's rusted out and it's got 200,000 miles on it, and and it's you know, the tires are flat. The you know, it doesn't run anymore, whatever. But this is the one that I want. Because I can see what happens when I replace body panels on it.
Yes.
When I put a new engine in it. When I put new tires on it. When I restore it to the beauty that it once had. Or even the beauty that it could have. And friends, that is the way that God looks at you and me. God doesn't necessarily see you in the jacked up situation that you're in. Yeah, God sees the jacked up situation that you're in. But it's not God's intent to leave you there. It's God's intent to rehab you, to restore you, to remake you, and to do something with it.
Amen.
And all of us have raw materials for God to work with. Let's look at what the word says in 2 Corinthians chapter 5. There's a word here that, because we're word people, so we got to add the word to it. So let's get some word. Let's see what we got. 2 Corinthians chapter 5.
2 Corinthians.
Verses 17 and 18.
Verses 17 and 18. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things become new.
Okay, now, the key to starting this process, Paul is writing here, 2 Corinthians chapter 5. If any man be in Christ, first criteria, be in Christ. Second thing, he is a new creature. Kind of like the caterpillar turning into a butterfly.
Metamorphosis.
It's the same caterpillar. But there has been a mighty, mighty change. It's the same house, same framework, same car, same transmission, same engine, same frame, same person, same temperament, same personality, same baggage, same bad experiences, same good experiences. But God wants to take and make the old, some things he wants to take out. Old things have passed away. and behold, all things become new.
Yes.
In other words, he's going to paint it. Some walls he's going to tear, some beams he's going to remove because they're rotted out. Mm-hmm. Some pipes he's going to remove because they're leaking. Some of the stuff, he might rip the whole entire roof off because it's not stable anymore. But he's going to rebuild it and make it brand new. What else do you have?
Now, all things are of God.
All things are of God. So everything that God does, as he rebuilds, rehabs, and regenerates, everything he puts in is of God.
Yes. Who has reconciled us to himself through Jesus Christ and has given us the ministry of reconciliation.
Give us 1 John chapter 3. God is in the process of rebuilding all things. And you know what, friends? I am so, so glad that when the Lord found me and when the Lord found you in the situations that we were in, he doesn't leave us the way that we are. He has something new. Something renewed, something restored, something refreshed. He regenerates.
Yes.
He regenerates. Amen. You know, he starts it all over again.
Mm.
So you may be 38, you may be 48, you may be 58, but it's never too late to start over.
Amen.
With the Lord.
Amen.
First John, what do you have?
Behold what manner of love the Father has bestowed on us, that we should be called the children of God. Therefore, the world does not know us because it did not know him. Mm. Beloved, now we are children of God, and it has not yet been revealed
what we shall be. Hold on. I hope you heard that, friends. The first thing I heard in verse 1, was that verse 1? Did you start at verse 1?
Yes.
Or you started at verse... Okay. One. So you went from 1 to 3. Listen. The first thing I heard was, behold! Mm-hmm. We don't use the term behold in our contemporary conversations.
Right.
But what the word behold would be akin to wow! Or look! In other words, I'm drawing your attention to something that's remarkable. I'm drawing your attention to something. Like, look, behold. And what does the word say? Behold what manner
of love. Yes.
Is this.
Yes, that the Father has bestowed on us.
That he bestowed on us. That we should be called the sons of God.
Yes.
Yes. He chooses wretches like you. Oh, now I know you don't want to say you was a wretch. You might have been a goody two-shoes wretch. But in the book of Isaiah, it makes it very clear that on our best day, our best righteousness.
Yes.
Is like filthy rags in Isaiah.
Yes.
The book of Romans makes it very clear that there is none righteous, no, not one. There's none that does good, no, not one. Mm. And there's none that seeks after God, no, not one.
Mm.
Makes it very clear, no, not one. So, yeah, you might not have been as much of a wretch as I was. You might have been quite as wretched as I was. But the fact is, to the extent that you were a wretch, God says that you were a wretch in need of salvation.
Yes.
Behold, what manner of love is this?
Mm.
That the Father have bestowed on us, that we should be called the sons of God. Mm. Finish reading the passage.
Beloved, now we are the children of God. It has not yet been revealed
what we shall be,
But we know that when he is revealed,
we will be like him, for we shall see him as he is. In other words, what God is making out of us, what God is regenerating and renewing in us, you might not know, or I might not know. Mm-hmm. It does not yet appear what we shall be, at least not to us. But we definitely know that it's good. But we know that we'll be like him when he is revealed. We shall see him as he is. Now, that's talking about spiritually while we're here on earth. And it's also talking about physically. We're talking about physical bodies now. That there's going to come a point in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 51 and 52 on down in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, that this mortal bodies will eventually put on immortality, and that the grave has no more sting and death has no more victory over your mortal bodies. Mm. We're talking about physical bodies now. Yes, there's going to eventually be new bodies. But from a spiritual standpoint, God is also in the business of renewing your spirit and making you like Christ. What a glorious thought.
Amen.
What do you have in Colossians? Colossians chapter 3, Colossians chapter 3 and verses 5 through 17. I want you to listen to these 12 verses, friends. Listen to these 12 verses. Paul is making it very clear to the church of Colossae. Colossae was the town.
Mm-hmm.
Paul is making it very clear. Colossians chapter 3. Verses 5 through 17. 12 verses she's going to read. Mm-hmm. Now listen to the stark contrast. There's a stark contrast of the old man, unregenerated, as we use in theological terms, and the new man, regenerated, restored,
yes,
renewed, rehabbed. Listen, there should be a difference. If you claim that you name the name of Christ, there should be a difference. If you've been in Christ for 5 years and you're still the same, then I would hate to have to tell you what Jesus told the Pharisees. Search the scriptures, for in them you think you have eternal life. But in Christ, there's always progress. Your progress may not be as fast as the next person. Your progress may not be the same as the next person. But in Christ, there's always progress. God is trying to get you to a point where he can use you as a vessel to glorify him and his name. Now, in Christ, there is a new creature. We just read in 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. That is literally talking about lifestyle, your lifestyle, the way that you think, the way that you act, the way that you approach things, the way that you approach people, the way that you live, the way you manage your money, what you set your affections on. The good news is that you don't have to do most of the work. Yes, you do have to do work. But God is working in you. both to will and to do unto his good pleasure. What we have to do is come into agreement with God and come into agreement with what he's doing. And friends, that may mean turning off certain radio stations. That may, well, that sounds legalistic. Well, you have to submit to God's process. That may mean turning off certain TV shows. It also may mean dropping off certain dead weight that's holding you back in the book of Hebrews, laying aside every weight and the sin that so easily besets us, and then let us run this race with patience. Patience literally meaning endurance. And you can endure longer and harder if you don't have the weight that you're carrying. Sometimes you just have to lay that stuff down. Sometimes you need to just cut folks off. Sometimes you need to cut certain things off. Jesus made a statement on that topic. He said, now, if your right hand, right hand offend you, be willing to cut it off. Because it's better for you to enter life maimed without the hand because you cut it off. So if it's your right hand that's causing you to be jacked up, cut it off. Because it's better for you to enter life maimed than to be whole with two hands and be cast into hell. That's what Jesus said. If your right eye, right eye offend you, pluck it out. Because it's better for you to enter life with one eye than with two eyes be cast into hell. Now listen, friends. Everything that we accomplish in this world and in this life takes effort. And oftentimes it takes us stepping out of our comfort zone. Stepping out sometimes of our friendship zone. See, so if we're connected with folks that's not going in the same direction, that presents a tug of war. I'm trying to go this way and you're trying to pull me that way. At some point, friends, you may have to make a hard decision. But it's your abundant life at stake.
You know, and I would even like to kind of throw this into the ring as well. Something that's not often talked about, I think, in ministry, or at least I personally haven't heard it enough, is that, you know, you may need to do some introspection also of, you know, your social media accounts and the things and the people that you follow and that you like and that you comment on, those things that could be, you know those things I'm talking about, those things that are provocative or sensual or sexual or derogatory, those things that we don't often talk about in ministry. You may need to unfriend some people. You may perhaps need to unfollow some pages. Perhaps you may need to take a second thought. The Lord's been prompting you about a particular thing that you've been engaged in on social media. And so those are the things too, because you said your lifestyle, not just in public, but also in private also. We need to look at those things and see where we can cut away the dross as well.
The dross. I'm glad you used the term dross. Dross is literally when you find a metallic element, as we talk about chromium or silver or gold or platinum or palladium. The purification process, let's talk about gold and silver. Let's just use that for an example. If we put it into, we use the term furnace. And I've seen this process happening with aluminum. But I particularly remember when I being in high school, we had an aluminum furnace in school. And in the aluminum furnace, we would put pieces of aluminum, and the furnace would heat the aluminum up, would heat it up so hot till the aluminum would melt and become liquid. And you would see the impurities, anything that's not aluminum, would rise out of the liquid to the top. And then you take and scrape off everything that's impure. That's called the dross. And it's the same similar concept with gold or with silver. And that, but God is in the process of working and transforming, renewing and rehabbing. Mm-hmm. It doesn't matter what situation you're in. It doesn't matter how messed up or see, we need to get to a point that we realize we're messed up and jacked up. I heard a preacher once say, an evangelist say, the hardest people to minister to and to witness to are church folks because they think that they're already in good shape. I just want to, just to rebound off of the point that you just made, mm-hmm. I'm going to read Romans chapter 12, verses 1, 2, and 3. Look what the word says. I beg you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. Look at this. Look at verse 2. And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good, acceptable, and perfect will of God. If you want to move and live in the will of God, it starts with not being conformed to the world.
Yes.
And then he puts it, drops a note in, how can I not be conformed to the world? By changing the stuff that you put into your mind.
Yes.
Renewing your mind. And that could mean renewing what you look at on the internet or what you listen to or the TV shows that you watch.
Yes.
Or the people you hang out with. Let me give you an example. I'll never forget one of her coworkers. I won't say the name, but she would come home and say that let me just give you this example. Imagine, let's just use the example of a single woman. Single woman. Okay? We have a single woman who claims to be a Christian, but all day long, she's listening to Fred Jackson. Okay, I'm in my 40s, folks. In fact, I'm closer to 50 than I am to 40. So, Fred Jackson, Luther Vandross, and for those that are in their 30s, Usher, and for those who are in their 20s, I don't know who the new artists are nowadays, but if you're listening to sexual stuff all day, then it's no wonder why you keep making phone calls and having rendezvous, and you wonder, because you're making your struggle more difficult. You're making your own struggle more difficult, because you're always doing things to ignite a fire of the flesh that can't be satisfied in a godly way.
Yes.
So what we need to do is make sure that we're renewing our minds. Mm-hmm. As there is a passage in Philippians, think on different things.
Yes.
Renew your mind in the book of Romans, like we just got finished reading.
Yes.
And that only helps your process.
Yes.
You know, it's like you can take you can build something in 2 weeks, or you can build it in 5 years. God can work on you for 1 year, or he can work on you for 10 years. The key is, how committed are you to the process that God is committed to? Let's get Colossians chapter 3, verses 5 through 17. So listen to these passages, friend. Listen to the stark contrast. This is Paul speaking. Colossians chapter 3, verses 5 through 17. What do you have?
Therefore, put to death your members.
Put to death.
Which are on the earth.
Strong language. Put to death.
Fornication, uncleanness, passion, evil desires, and covetousness, which is idolatry.
Okay.
Because of these things, the wrath of God is coming upon the sons of disobedience.
Pause right there. God is loving. God is grace. In First John, gracious. In First John, God is love. But what she just read, because of these things, the wrath of God comes upon the children of disobedience. The God of the Bible does have a wrath, because he's perfectly holy and he's perfectly just. Mm-hmm. So to say that God is holy, but to say that he's loving is not somehow oxymoronic.
Mm-hmm.
No. You can be loving and yet still get angry. Okay, so let's get a little bit more. Which you used to live in some of these things. Read that.
Because of these things, the wrath of God is coming upon the sons of disobedience, in which you yourselves once walked.
When you lived this way. So he's talking to believers. Now, if I'm a believer, these things should be past tense in my life. Beautiful, beautiful picture.
Yes.
Compare that to the new man. What do you have?
But now. You yourselves are to put off all these things. Anger, wrath, malice, blasphemy, filthy language out of your mouth. Do not lie one to another.
Don't lie to each other, friends.
Since you have put off the old man with his deeds and have put on a new man who is renewed in knowledge of
renewed.
God.
Renewed. See, there's that word we
who
used.
Created you.
That's the word we used. Renewed. Get a little bit more.
Where there is neither Greek nor Jew, circumcised nor uncircumcised, barbarian
or Scythian. Now listen to what he's saying. From a religious standpoint, mm-hmm. once you come to Christ and you put the new man on, mm-hmm. like she just described it, the unity of the body of Christ is so united that yes. there is no religious difference.
Mm-hmm.
And what else is in that list?
Slave nor free. But Christ.
There is no power difference. There is no hierarchy in Christ. And barbarian or Scythian. Now some may be physicians and some may be janitors.
Mm-hmm.
You know, none of that makes a difference in Christ. None of that makes a difference in Christ. If you are a barber or if you're an auto mechanic, if you're a painter, if you're a white collar, if you're blue collar, if you're an attorney, if you're an engineer, if you're an accountant, it does not matter. Doesn't matter if you live on the east side. Mm-hmm. Doesn't matter if you live downtown. Doesn't matter if you live uptown or if you none of that matters in Christ. The beautiful thing is that the Lord brings it all together in love,
yes.
and in unity.
Yes.
If everybody's walking in the new man, then we're not lying to each other. We're not sleeping with each other. You know, we're not mad at each other. We're not causing drama and confusion. She just read that.
Mm-hmm.
It's a beautiful, beautiful thing how these two different,
yes.
States of life are
yes.
juxtaposed
mm-hmm.
before Christ and after Christ. Wow, was that verse 17? Oh, you had something.
I did. I wanted to kind of revisit the issue with the social media because I know that's something where a lot of us nowadays where we intersect. So you may not necessarily know a person, but you may be a friend of theirs or follow that page. And so, you know, as Christians, you know, I don't want to blame all of our shortcomings on social media. I'm not here to do that. But I am here to say that we need to be careful and vigilant and stay awoke, because you don't want the enemy to weaponize social media where it becomes like an incubator, and it accelerates a process of you being drawn away from the Lord. So I'm saying to you, if you're part of things that are taking place, even if it's not, I guess in real life, in social media life, be careful and be vigilant that you are abstaining from things that will cause you to fall away from the Lord or turn away from him or denounce his promises or forsake or abort his promises over your life. I'm saying this and I'm pleading with you out of passion. I've seen people drawn away. And in compassion as well. Yes. I've seen folks drawn away, and I've seen how the enemy can use the social media and the internet and the cyberspace to draw people. And really, it's the root issues of the heart. But as I said before, these platforms become incubators.
Yes, they do.
To draw out these issues
incubator.
That are in our hearts already that we're struggling and wrestling with. So be careful and be vigilant. Keep your eyes, you know, keep your eyes awake. Keep them open. Stay before the Lord. Stay prayerful. And if there's anything that you know in your spirit and you've been feeling prompted or convicted, the Holy Spirit has been kind of just, you know, pecking at your heart, and you know that those are things or areas where you struggle, you may just have to unfollow. You may just have to unfriend. You may just have to set up certain parameters and boundaries, and ask the Lord just to help you to get victory and control and to put to death those members and those things that are causing you to be drawn away into your own lust.
Wow, that's strong and stiff and prophetic. That's for somebody. I don't know who that's for, but it's definitely for somebody. This is something clearly that the Holy Spirit is saying.
Yeah, we didn't intend to go there tonight.
Yeah, I mean, I didn't intend to say nothing like that, but certainly that's something the Holy Spirit is saying. So, but take heed. But listen, she talks about the incubators for things to grow that is already in your heart, so that you fight harder against issues that the Lord is currently giving you victory over. Listen, friends. The Lord has given you victory. He's given you freedom. Your future is ready, set, go. What we do oftentimes, what I have done, my wife hasn't done it, but what I have done, what many of us do oftentimes, and I say this with as much spirit of compassion and empathy as I can, yet I still want to stay solid in the point that we make our process harder than it has to be. And we cause our process to last longer than it has to last. God is eager and excited to get us to a point of glorifying Him. God is eager and excited to get us to a point where we glorify Him. Oftentimes, we are the ones that prolong the process, and we make our own process more difficult than it has to be. And sometimes it is a matter of just turning things off or unfriending someone. Listen, friends, get your victory.
Amen.
Get your victory. Live in it. Walk in it.
Yes.
You know, don't be like me. And I can say this unashamed, that there are some years in Christ that I didn't make full use of for a variety of reasons. There are some things that God wants to work in you that will blow your mind, and it's beautiful. And so my word of encouragement for you is, you decide that 2019 is going to be your year with the Lord.
Yeah.
It's going to be your just word year.
Yeah.
And it's going to be your year with the Lord until you get that much closer to your destiny. In fact, just grab hold of your destiny this year.
Jesus.
Just grab hold of it. God is not keeping it away from you. He wants you to run with Him. You know, but oftentimes, like Lot's wife, God wants us to run off into a place of freedom. But we keep looking back.
Or like the children of Israel, you know, when the Lord delivered them with a mighty hand, and He demonstrated His sovereignty, and He had prepared a land, you know, generations before. He was about to fulfill His promise, and they started getting weary and complaining, and we should have never left Egypt. And they began to doubt God and complain, and couldn't lay hold of the promise in their heart. And so, you know, it took them longer than it needed to take them to get to their promised land and their destiny. God wasn't withholding the promise from them.
Yes.
He already promised it to them, to their forefathers.
Yes.
And He brought them out of bondage.
Just to take them to their destiny.
Just to take them to the promised land. But it's because of the condition of our hearts.
Yes.
That we prolong getting to that place, that destiny, that place that God has called and prepared for us, that's flowing with milk and honey.
Yes.
we prolong and we meander along, wondering if Egypt had something better to offer us.
No, it doesn't. I love it to tell people I got married at 20 years old. I love to tell people that. I love it. I'm serious, friends. I love to tell people I got married at 20 years old.
Why are you so joyful to share that
with people? I love to tell people that because there's nothing apart from my wife that is in the world that I'm missing.
Amen.
I'm serious. And that's the same example of what you just used. There is nothing to look back to in Egypt. The picture might look pretty until you actually get there. And then there's drama.
Yeah.
There's baggage. There's foolishness. There's bondage. Just release it and move forward with the new thing that God has for you.
Yeah, you know,
it's just a beautiful, beautiful thing.
And as I remember reading about their sojourn from Egypt and how they begin to reflect back on the fruit and the food and the way of life in Egypt and how they somehow forgot to remember that as the Lord was about to deliver them, the pressure became more intense. They had to work harder.
Yeah, sometimes it's like that in the Lord.
But that's just because the Lord was about to do something magnificent and release them from that bondage. And so it's funny how they often looked back and remembered what they had that was good, but didn't remember all that was bad when they were in bondage.
Wow. Wow. So in other words, sometimes in Christ, and here's the thing about it. Right before the Lord explodes a tremendous blessing on you, you have to understand that even as Israel was going through the wilderness, getting to the point where they're going to cross over into the Jordan River, they still had enemies fighting them. The Moabites, the Ammonites, the Edomites. And then even once they got across the river into Canaan, there was the Hivites who came to make peace with them. Which was a good thing. The Hivites made peace with them. But then you still had the Jebusites, the Hittites, and particularly down in the southeastern corner, there was the Philistines and the various different ones. Sometimes living a blessed life in Christ is a fight to maintain
it. My Lord.
It's a fight to get there and it's a fight to maintain it. But my God, is it worth it?
Yes.
I'd rather have what God has for me.
Well.
Than to live in Egypt under a hard taskmaster.
My Lord.
I'm just telling you. Jesus said, I came, and he's literally talking about land flowing with milk and honey. I came that they might have life, that you and I might have life, and life more abundantly. But the thief cometh not, but to steal, kill and destroy. It's like a rat trap. The cheese looks good, but if I get close enough to it, pow, it leads to nothing but death and destruction. You laughing at that? Okay, let's get the rest of Colossians and then let's go to we're going to get Titus chapter 3, which is one of my favorite passages in all of the Word. Titus chapter 3, verses 3 through 5. Finish up Colossians.
Therefore, verse 12. Therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved, put on tender mercy.
Tender mercy.
Kindness. Humility.
Humility.
Meekness. Long suffering. Bearing with one another.
Bearing with one another.
Forgiving one another.
Forgiving one another.
If anyone has a complaint against another, even as Christ forgave you, so you also must do. But above all these things, put on love, which is the bond of perfection.
Beautiful.
And let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to which also you were called in one body. And be thankful.
Beautiful, beautiful picture.
Let the word of Christ dwell richly in you in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord.
See that?
And whatever you do in word or in deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ.
You see, this is a beautiful, beautiful picture and a stark, stark contrast. And here's the line that I really like. Part of the reason why we call this the Just Word Show. And let the word, what does it say about the word there in that verse?
Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom.
Richly in all wisdom and teaching.
And admonishing one another in psalms and hymns.
Yeah, so we need to be admonishing each other. And we need, see, here's the key. Letting the word dwell richly in you. All right, Titus chapter 3 and verse 3. Do you have that yet? Listen to this. Titus chapter 3 and verse 3. Very similar to Colossians chapter 3. Titus chapter 3 and verse 3. For we ourselves were once also foolish. Listen, past tense.
Yes.
For we ourselves were once also foolish, disobedient, and deceived, serving various lusts and pleasures, living in malice and envy, hateful and hating each other.
My God.
But God has a great big but. And here it comes right here. But in verse 4. The kindness and the love of God, our Savior, towards man appeared, not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy he saved us. By the washing, and there's that word, and regeneration. And listen to the word, renewing of the Spirit, whom he poured out upon us. That being justified by his grace, we should become heirs according to the hope of eternal life. Mm. Wow. What a powerful, powerful picture.
Yes.
God is in the business of renewing, regenerating, rehabbing. And in John chapter.
Reconciliation.
He's given us the ministry of reconciliation in 2 Corinthians chapter 5. And reconciled us to him. And given us the ministry of reconciliation in 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Renewing of the Spirit. Now he rehabs, he renews in John chapter 3. Rebirth. Give you a new chance at life. Another chance. A second chance. I don't care if you blew the last 30 years. The Lord can restore all the years that the locust and the palmer worm and the canker worm have eaten. He can restore all of that. 20 years, 30 years. Mm. Mistakes, he can clean them up. Or better yet, he can use it for his glory.
My Lord.
Because the stuff that you've been through makes you more usable.
Mm-hmm.
Because there's more people that you can minister to that if you had not gone through those things, you wouldn't be able to minister to them as effectively. Beautiful. Let's get a... Listen, God's given new hearts. He'll even give you a new heart. Give us Ezekiel chapter 36. Verse 21 through 26. Listen. While she's finding it, the Lord does these things. It benefits you and it glorifies his name.
Mm.
And he uses you as a vessel to glorify his name. Do you have Ezekiel 36 21 through 26? Listen, it glorifies his name. It's not about you, friends. Well, yes, it is about you, but it's about him more than it's about you. You're second on the list, but ultimately it's about his name. What do you have?
But I had a concern for my holy name, which the house of Israel had profaned among the nations whenever they went,
mm-hmm.
wherever they went. Therefore, say to the house of Israel, thus says the Lord God, I do not do this for your sake, O house of Israel, but for my holy name's sake.
For his holy name's sake.
Which you have profaned among the nations wherever you went. And I will sanctify my great name, which has been profaned among the nations.
I will sanctify my name,
which you have profaned in their midst. And the nation shall know that I am the Lord, says the Lord God, when I am hallowed in you before their eyes. For I will take you from among the nations, gather you out of all of the countries, and bring you into your own land. Then I will sprinkle clean water
on you. Clean water on you.
And you shall be clean.
And you shall be clean. This is God working.
I will cleanse you from all filthiness and from all your idols.
I will cleanse you from filthiness.
I will give you a new heart.
I will take your heart of stone from your flesh and give you a heart of flesh. I'm sorry. Go ahead and finish.
I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit within you. I will take the heart of stone out of your flesh and give you a heart of flesh.
Now, keeping everything in context. Understand, I always encourage folks, literary context, historic context. He's speaking directly to Israel. He's speaking directly to Israel. But we can extract a principle about God's character. Mm-hmm. As God is interested in glorifying his own name.
Mm-hmm.
And he will use you to glorify his name. And if you're willing to submit to what it is that God is doing, he will fill you with his spirit and he will change your heart.
Mm-hmm.
Beautiful. Beautiful. We got some passages in 1 Peter and we get ready to close out. Oh, wait a minute. Just give us one passage in 1 Peter. 1 Peter chapter 1.
Okay.
And then I'm just going to read these lyrics real quick from one of my favorite songs. And we're going to close out with
verses
my song. 1 Peter chapter 1. What does that say?
1 Peter chapter 1 verses 3 through 4. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his abundant mercy has begotten us again to a living hope.
You see that? A living hope. Begotten us. That means new birth to a living hope.
Through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled that does not fade away, reserved in heaven for you.
For you. Get the last one, verse 23, and I'm going to start reading this. It's not a dead hope, it's a living hope.
Mm-hmm. 1 Peter verse 23.
New life right here, new life. Listen to it, friend.
Having been born again.
Born again.
Not of corruptible seed, but incorruptible, through the word of God.
Why the word of God is so important?
Which lives and abides forever.
Listen, friends. Oh, what a privilege to be related and called the Son of the Righteous One, the Holy One, the Father and the King. He's the Prince of Peace. He reigns in royalty. Many treasures now belong to us. We're the children of the King. You may not feel like it. You may not look like it. But you are right now his son. So move in power and talk of victory.
Mm.
Our Father is the Lord of all, and now are we his sons.
Yes.
Listen to what the word says. What manner, it's actually the chorus of the song, but it's also the word. What manner of love is this? That he would choose a wretch like me. He chose me to be his son. He picked me up and made me new. A vessel made for him to use. He chose me to be his son. What manner of love is this? Right now, we're his sons.
Mm.
It does not yet appear.
Yes.
What we're going to be. but we are going to be like him.
Amen.
What a mighty, mighty, mighty word.
Yes.
What a mighty word, friends. All hope is not lost. God is always ready to restore. Well, we come to the worst part of the show, the part that all of us hate, the part where we have to close out on the Just Word Show. Hey, thank you for allowing us to come into your cell phones, your computers, your living rooms, your automobiles, your offices, or however it is that you listen or watch the Just Word Show right here on Awesome God Radio or Facebook or YouTube. Check us out on YouTube. You can literally type in the Just Word Show. It comes up. You'll see the beautiful red. You click on it and you avail yourself of the wonderful teaching that we try to present every week. If you like it, click on, subscribe, share it with a friend. Let folks know that there's a blessing right here on the Just Word Show. Until next week, this is Brother Julius and my beautiful wife, Lysandra, signing off.
Son of the righteous one, the holy one, the father of the king. He's the prince of peace, crowned in royalty. Many treasures now belong to us. We're the children of a king. You may